expiration period, yes.
So, and we're gonna vote on it this week, next week?
Yes, we have already, just to inform you, it will be going to the Board of Commissioners in July. We did have to submit that legal ad, so it will go before the board in July. We are asking that you make a recommendation next Tuesday.
Well, I'm kinda like, I mean, when you say imperpetuity, I mean, that kinda scares me a little. So I'm not, and I know Alan was a little concerned, you got that change, but what, is there some other way to do it rather than just forever like this?
Well, we were directed, staff was directed by the Board of Commissioners to make the change, so we executed the change and put in perpetuity. That was their request. And then when Alan brought up the concerns, we looked at modifying it. So really, it is a discussion point at this time.
There's a lot of different ways you can do it.
What?
There are a lot of different ways you can do it.
Yeah, and we can do kind of what we want to, make recommendations, and then they can vote on perpetuity, which is probably what they wanted to do, or they wouldn't have sent it down like we did.
It was,
but there's nothing wrong with us doing something different to give them another idea.
I want to hear your ideas. Yeah. About 2 years ago, a variance was only good for 1 year. And then there was a code change. It went to 4 years plus one additional year at my discretion.
Mm-hmm.
And now the proposal is just to take all the time.
So what's wrong with the 4 years plus one? I think I remember voting on that.
What's wrong with it? I can tell you what's wrong with it. Just, it's a, there's a,
there must be something they want to change.
Where I see it come up sometimes as a challenge, and we saw it a lot over the last 5 years, projects that were slow to be finished out, projects that started, and then a variance was granted, and there was anticipation that the project was going to be done in a year, and all of a sudden 4 years have come and gone and nothing has happened.
Guess what? The horse is out of the barn. And things have turned around, and that's not going to happen anymore, maybe for a long time, we hope. In other words, this is almost trying to fix a problem that's already been solved.
Heard it here. Okay. Jay's confident the economy is going
to be yeah, well, I mean, it's so not going to be like it was.
In order to have you talk about this wording, do we need to make a motion tonight, or?
What would need to occur would be,
if they want, we could work it into our presentation if that's what they want.
Absolutely, and that's why I do, if the commission is interested in this, I do recommend that we put it on the screen.
Yeah. Well, this is a little bit more of what you had in mind, isn't mm-hmm. it?
Yeah, I mean, my concern about in perpetuity was that if the zoning changed, say that it was residential and you got the zoning buffer reduced, mm-hmm. and then it became a industrial use, then that variance would still exist. Even with the zoning change, it wouldn't eliminate that. So this would get rid of that. Same thing with conditional uses. If you change the use, then you're not going to be able to get that variance. And I was curious about how variances expire. Say that you have, because this is where I thought that a time limit on a variance is an issue, is say that you have a site and somebody gets a variance to a buffer and they're actively using that area. After 5 or 6 years, that area that they were actively using, would they have to go and get a variance again because that area is not buffered? If they say that they make an expansion or a change to the site, would that variance not come into play that, well, that variance has expired, so you need to re-up your...
I will typically see it as that they'll have a development permit to divest that variance. So within the 4 years, say it's a stream buffer, you got to reduce down to 50 to 35 feet. Within those first 4 years, they get the land disturbance, clear that varianced area, and then are covered in the future for doing things in that area. Had they done nothing, no land disturbance, that's when the expiration would be an issue.
So the development permit would essentially make that variance permanent.
Yeah, and it gets to be a bit of a complicated one where if we ever had one that was really a you know, a challenging issue, you probably have a legal staff weighing in on it, and it becomes a bit of a, becomes very much a legal discussion about vested interest in the property. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to say just absolutely the development permit would always do that. But from trying to keep it general, trying not to get lost in the legalities of it, I would say, yeah, that's a pretty good way to look at it, is once you act on it, you've got it.
Okay.
But I see this as trying to fix something that's already cured itself for the time being. And we can always, it could always be changed later, you know, and, but once it's in perpetuity, that's, like, well,
to,
I guess they can change
it. We're all on the same page. What's in your book, what's in the actual document the legal ad ran on, uh-huh, is perpetuity.
Uh-huh.
The additional suggestion by Alan is saying perpetuity, but not if it's rezoned.
Yeah.
So it's,
like,
it's putting
four year
limit on it.
I was here when we voted for the 4 year plus one, I think. Wasn't
I think, yeah.
Okay, I like what I voted for right then. And, okay, you know, and I don't know if I mean, the commission might change their mind because it's, you know, it's not, maybe when they started talking about it 6 months ago, it was maybe still been an issue, but okay, today y'all are getting.
And if you don't like, if you don't like the concept of perpetuity, I want to make clear to you is, and you don't like what's in the book.
Yeah, and I'm going to
not necessarily, it's not necessarily the handout, it's the book that you have concerned
with. Uh-huh. You know, I'm not trying to telegraph my vote, but I'm just saying that I'm satisfied with the 4+1. Don't see any need to change it. So, make you want.
So, if we want you to go over this in the public hearing tonight, all we need to do is tell you that we would like for you to present it.
Yes.
Publicly.
Yes.
And I think right now, not hearing anyone saying no, we'll just do that. We'll
I think it'd probably be better
to incorporate that. We'll just bring
think,
it up that
yeah,
this
incorporate
came as a
it.
Suggestion from the Planning Commission. We had the language drafted. Here it is. If you want to incorporate it in your motion forward, it's been shown on the screen. You can use
and then it. I can bring up my point if I want to.
Correct.
Are you going to talk about the rest of these?
Do you have specific questions? What I'll be doing is what I did last time, unless there are specific questions, which is I'll provide a summary of the bundle of changes, what they pertain to, and then, you know, withdrawal, the public hearing will be open, and of course I'm available to answer questions on any section of the bundle, the UDC bundle, since it's
a Do you have more questions?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can I address the residential districts?
The performance standards is what you want to talk about.
Table 11.2b. Mm-hmm. I think you're prepared to talk in some detail about some of this. I'm looking at the overall picture, and just as a suggestion, trying to simplify things for everybody. Right now, res 1 is 1 unit per acre, res 2 is 2 units per acre, res 3 is 2.5 or 2.2, res 4 is 3.6. Res 5 is not
right
listed.
Right now it's 4.
Yeah, 4. More than they
can. They want
three.
It to be 3.6.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I was just throwing out these numbers. In other words, res 3 is not 3, like res 2 is 2, and res 4 is not. Well, it is 4.
That's what
there's a reason for that.
Yeah.
You know what the reason is, right?
Well, I mean, what I'm going to say, and then you can take over. I'm just thinking that we don't use res 2 very much for zoning. So that would be a good place to change. And I think res 3 at 3 units per acre in today's environment has a place for 3 units per acre. So my suggestion is to leave res 3 at, or not leave it, but change it to 3 per acre. Leave res 4 at 4 rather than making it 3, and 5 would be 5 and 6 would be 6. And then 2 could be 2.5 or 2.2. You know, in other words,
well,
this, and it would still be in the twos.
Why would we want three to be three, four to be four, one to be one, and then two to not be?
Because that would be just the only, it would still be in the twos, 2.2 or 2.5. It would still be in there. Whereas res three is going to be 2 point something, which doesn't flow with res three. And then res four is going to be 3 point something, which doesn't flow with four. But at least res two would be 2.2, or it'd be in the range. So then when you're talking about it, it's pretty clear.
So you want a greater density for res two than what it has right now. This is the max.
Yeah, because we never use it.
So my,
if we used it, but it's not.
I mean, we don't have it a lot on the. We don't have it right now. We don't have a lot of it. We have mostly res three is on our map, right? When you look at the map, it's most of it's res three. I'm on board with the. Makes logical sense. Res one, yeah, res two, res three, res four. I mean, people get that. It's very straightforward. And my issue with it right now is that it says it's a maximum density.
So we're
at a maximum density per acre. If we did a maximum density per acre of three and for res three, what people would have to understand is you can only get three units per acre if you have a 1 acre tract with no unusable land and it's exactly a square and you can put three houses on three different sides and put driveways in and there's already roads around it.
Makes the land more valuable. It's
you see what I'm saying? Because you'll never get three units per acre.
Yeah, it's not a perfect world.
Because you're not going to have a piece of land that's a square, flat, with only three driveways going in. Do you see what I'm saying, though?
I see what you're saying.
Because if you calculate the lot size based on the 43,560 square feet per acre, and you consider that on most Res 3 subdivisions, you're going to get about 60% of that is going to be lot size, lots, and 40% of it is going to be extra stuff. Your roads, your detention, all that kind of stuff. I'm just saying, consider that.
I'm considering.
And you divide it out, then you can't get three units per acre on that land with these lot sizes.
Try.
You've got.
So it is a maximum, and I totally agree with the maximum. But people have to realize that just because it's on there as a maximum doesn't mean you're really ever going to get it.
But you're going to use these districts basically depending on the characteristics of the land anyway. I mean, you're not going
to. I think you think I'm disagreeing with you when
I'm not.
No,
I don't think you're disagreeing. Because
I'm not disagreeing with you. I'm just saying I'm adding more to it.
And I'm adding to. I'm in total agreement with what you're saying. I mean, I have not. I'm just saying that you can't put res 3 on a piece of property that won't support res 3.
Well, and the other thing is you have to realize that if it's a maximum density and we go with it as a maximum density, you're not going to ever get that as an actual density, like I said, unless you're on a square piece of land.
Well, what about we haven't ever done
it that way before. Yeah. So in the past, we hover around the density at what it says it should be, right?
But what if you got a res 2 on a terrible piece of property?
Well, there's two different issues here. One is that the geometry, you've got the minimum, the densities, but then you also have geometric constraints that will lead you to a density. And
that's what I'm saying.
Those two should correlate at the end of the day, or else really why not just get rid of the density or get rid of the geometric standards?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Because at the end of the day we're putting two different things there and they're not going to add up. And that's, I think, from talking, and discussing it last time, discussing it with the commissioners that sent it to us, that was what the issue was, is everybody saying that we've got this 14,500 square feet on res 3. If we can't hit better than 2.2 units per acre, then why don't you just drop that down You know, there's right-of-way area, and the area gets taken up by right-of-way. You have your stormwater management that area gets taken up by. You've got your 15% open space on res 3. So you start adding all those things up, and when you do the math, I mean, at 14.5, you would only get about 2.2.
So
you'd have to get down.
So basically, what I'm saying then is right now, we're not using res 2.
Mm-hmm.
And if we change it like I'm thinking about, and I mean, it's up for discussion. I'm not hardcore on. We'll be using res 2 a good bit, but we won't be using res 3. Mm-hmm. Which is the same, basically the same thing.
The same problem.
Yeah, the same thing is what we're doing, except that the 1, 2, 3, and 4 will line up, and it just makes more common mm-hmm. sense. Even though you're still going to have a zoning district,
but then
that
it doesn't line up with
a
comprehensive plan.
Well, if we do it right now, Tom can tell me if I'm wrong about this, but just looking at what zonings are coming in. We would end up, if we change res 2 to 2.2, we would end up getting people zoning res 4 at 2.2 is what we would get. Because they need the geometry of res 4 for the product that people want, but they would be zoning at a density of 2.2.
Right. And there's a lot of consideration on doing that tonight.
That is what would happen.
Yep.
And I mean, and that's, I understand we might be doing, thinking in terms of that with something we're going to do later on this evening.
I do want to say that all the options, whether it's this option on the paper or the option Jody mentioned or tweaking, that all of this would be in compliance with a comprehensive plan as far as the character area and the descriptions. We do not tie the character areas to specific density numbers, which means these performance standards can shift and change. And with the numbers that we're talking about right now, without more, you know, significant changes, there would not be any discrepancies. So at this point in this conversation and the numbers we're batting about, it would be fine as far as the
character. Okay. So it doesn't change the public because you had something about changing.
So basically what I'm saying is I'm kind of thinking out of the box of what the commissioners are saying, just like I did on the first thing. You know, I've got an idea, you know, if the commissioners want to listen to it, fine. If they don't, fine. But I'm floating the idea out there. And I mean, we could float this if y'all are interested in it. I think it makes
so
perfectly
what
good
are you
sense.
So what are you recommending for the lot size?
That's up to you.
Up to me?
Well, you're more of an expert on that than I am.
Well, I don't know if I'm an expert, but...
My expertise is coming up with the idea.
Oh.
Getting the specifics.
Very good.
It's up to the rest of you. That's if you don't like my idea, then that's fine too.
I'm open to the idea. I'm just
okay.
It will change.
Tell me what you think.
I mean, it would change the. You'd then have to change the lot size,
uh-huh.
which so is why they're changing the lot. Which the suggestion of changing lot size for the res 3 is because at 2.5 units per acre, when you take the 60%, you couldn't get 14.5.
Yeah, but you
just
put that on
it was.
Too.
That was
it was
all this
nearly
came about.
Impossible. I mean, mm-hmm. I calculated it 1,000 different ways. There was,
yeah.
I mean, you really couldn't figure it out.
We'll put it on res 2 over here. Yeah.
And so cool. You have to, they're taking it down to the 10.5 because what was in it before was the 3.0
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
at 9,000.
Okay.
So you got,
so you
got,
you did your homework.
Not, I always do my homework. You got 9,000 square foot lots. In 2006, they were 9,000 square foot lots with open space of 20%, minimum house size of 1250, and a 3.0 density, which worked out. But then they went up to 14.5
mm-hmm.
at 2.5 density, and the calculations are just not there.
Mm-hmm.
So what we have to figure out is what. If you want to change it, then you're going to have to change. I mean, you can't go with 18.5
That's not in my thought process. My thought process is just to get us. We this came through us last work session.
Boom!
Right by us. I've raised my hand and said, well, let's talk about it a little bit. That's where I am. You know, and not only am I saying let's talk about it, I'm saying here's a suggestion. And that's like doing our job. And, you know, if you like it is, or what, you know, that's fine. I'm just throwing an idea out there.
Well, I understand where they're going with it. I understand where they're going with it. They're saying the 14.5 is impossible. So they want to make it a smaller lot size.
Mm-hmm.
But they don't want to give up everything. So they're lessening the density. Yeah.
And they're not messing with the res too, which we never hardly ever use anyway. So I'm just, that's...
Well, right now we hardly ever use the res 3, right?
Yeah, everybody is asking... Well, for the most part, the majority of folks coming in are asking for res 4, and it's because of these issues that they're having to deal with.
So what do you think? I think Vanessa's, whatever your opinion is, probably would probably carry the day for me, you know, but I'm just thinking... I'm not trying to put pressure on you either. I'm just
put Vanessa on
because,
the hot seat.
Well, no, I'm not, because everybody's independent. They're gonna make their own minds up. But I mean, basically, I heard you say it has merit.
I said that it would be an issue with a comprehensive plan. Uh-huh. I think these changes, you know, my professional planning guidance would be that there are a lot of market conditions, and that there are developers out there with different needs. And perhaps more of that information could be brought to the table.
Well, so the other thing
see,
is...
that's a really good point.
So how do we
there's a lot of different developers, and they all have different needs, and we need to address all of them, not just a few.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. Why don't we come up with our plan rather than a developer's plan?
So do you think we're rushing this right now? We should maybe get some more information? Is that your advice?
That could be one option. Another option would be, you know, we've made changes before. I'm sure we'll make changes again, and those changes could continue on.
And that's what I'm trying to do is fix it so we're not changing it a lot. I'd like for us to spend a little time on it and get it to a position where it might last for a while, you know, rather than we're changing it. And I think with a little bit of work on it, you know, I think we might be able to accomplish that. But again, we can put a lot of work in it, and the commissioners can just go to this. But the bottom line for me is, I would like the Planning Commission to be in charge of this rather than the developers.
You'll have your recommendation.
That's the point.
More res 4 applications. I think that's a big part of where this came from. We have, going through this morning, all the applications we have that have been submitted but not yet made it to the Planning Commission, there's not a single res 3 in there. There's four res 4s. So everyone we're seeing now for the first time rezoning applications come back. It's been a long time where we didn't see residential rezoning applications. They're coming back, and they're coming back almost 100%. Res 4 with a couple res 6s mixed in there. Mm-hmm. So,
and we do have a comprehensive plan problem with that, because the majority of our map is suburban living and the maximum is res 3 for the suggested zoning district. So we do have a comprehensive planning issue when it comes to that when we do our staff reviews.
Yeah, and Pam hit on exactly
that. That's why my point was
Pam hit directly on my issue is rather than trying to please two or three two or three developers, let's try to do something that's good for the county and as many developers as we could help. I don't want to come across and say I don't want to listen to developers.
You're not concerned that the upping this density is going to have citizens concerned?
Well, they'll have to answer your question, yes, I am concerned. I'm thinking that we can possibly do better. But if y'all don't think so, then that's fine. We can, and I can understand that, because the commissioners are going to do what they want to, regardless of what we recommend. But I think it would be good for us to do some due diligence and look into it and try to do a good job. I mean, we're trying to get this commission turned around where we're really involved, and this is a place where we can be.
I mean, I think we've been doing our homework.
Uh-huh. But you weren't here last year.
No.
Okay. So we're doing a lot better. I'm glad you're here.
Thank you.
So, Alan, too. So that's what I mean, it's, I'm not hard and fast on that at all. It's just me thinking that, you know, maybe we can do more to help the Board of Commissioners.
I mean, I think it's a great suggestion. It's good that we're asking the question. I mean, why are some of the numbers different? I do think that, you know, right now, it would be good to get more information from people in a broader development community where you're able to find out, because there's some developers that may not be here because we don't have something. You know, talk about, you know, someone that's going to do a more innovative type of development. Well, if we don't have anything that accommodates them, they may not even be looking in this market in the first place. So trying to ask and get some information is good. I do think that would take time, and that's something that would be great for us to pursue. I would love to see us pursue that. But at the same time, with all the RES4s coming in, I've wondered if it wouldn't be better to go ahead and adjust areas, whether we adjust areas and densities or areas, so that these RES4s don't keep coming in right now. And then, I mean, if we start this back in 1 or 2 months, it's no different from if we go back and start trying to do that now, because if we change these, it's still got to go through 2 public hearings. Is that right? So, I mean, what it is right now, I think, is set so that, unfortunately, we have to keep tweaking this just to be able to make the zoning fit the market. And if we adjust these for the short term as a short term fix, knowing that we need to get away from trying to find a way to limit the market, that's kind of my.
Sometimes those short term fixes end up being the fix for a year or two.
Sure, I understand that too.
You know, at some point in time, you just got to stand up and say, hey, now I don't have all the details because I didn't put the effort forth to look into them because I'm just floating the idea.
Sure.
You know, and I mean, I didn't want to put tons of work or hours into it and then have it all turned down. But it sounds like it, I don't know, I hadn't heard from y'all.
Is it a time-sensitive thing where they want this done, or are we in a time crunch because we already had one public hearing?
The time-sensitivity is the fact that we have advertised it for the July 2nd public hearing before the Board of Commissioners. So that is an item that is on their agenda, will be on their agenda.
And the UDC, because you've already held a public hearing, you have 31 days to make your recommendation. Our meeting falls on the 28th day. We're not going to have another meeting before that deadline hits. So, for a variety of reasons, this is our last chance at the Planning Commission to make a recommendation on this particular product. Not that we can't continue to talk about this and try to.
On another note, with this that we haven't discussed yet is the. I think it's the old R1R, whatever R2R. Where it's a more varied size lots within each neighborhood, and I think it was based on an average, something similar to that, or a percentage of lots were a certain size. Do we know why we went away from something like that?
That particular district was CR1.
Okay.
That particular district, it was popular just 15 years ago, we went to smaller lots in general, and it required an overall density of 1 unit per acre and an average lot size of 19,000 square feet. A lot of our golf course communities got built under the zoning.
Well, we couldn't do something similar just on a smaller size.
We could, yeah. We've been talking some about the concept with fresh numbers in it.
That we don't, that we're not necessarily looking for in the community could be adjusted, and wouldn't all of our neighborhoods wouldn't look exactly the same if we had some variation in the zoning, because right now we're zoning it and you've got to have a certain lot size and you got to have a certain density and you've got to have an exact setback and everything.
That's what the developers
so
want
specific.
And that's what I'm trying to say, you know, rather than us being at the mercy of the developers coming in, like that was popular. When you said it was popular, basically, I think to finish your sentence, that was popular with the developers several years ago. Is that right?
Lot sizes have evolved as we move from a rural
because
to a more
the rural developers area. Are changing and the markets change. But we can. I'm basically saying, let's let the county get in control of what we're doing and not just be responding to the developers. And we can have a lot more control over, and when I say we, I'm actually talking about the Board of Commission because I had this process. And it would be, I think that would be helpful what an idea for the county to be in control of what's going on. I mean, what a novel idea. You know, so that's the bottom line of what I'm talking about.
One thing I'll say when you're looking at res 3, 4, and 6, regardless of which numbers, the difference between the lot sizes is relatively small. When we were looking at our older districts, the variability between the lot sizes was much larger. So when you're discussing a range, the consequence of a range when you have lot sizes that have a lot more difference between them, and you're going to try to apply a range within, you know, our current districts, it might not be as successful because right. You're talking about, again, such a small change, unless for whatever reason you wanted to really change the number and make more differences between res 3, 4, and 6. Good, you know, when you're talking 2,000, you know, square right. feet, there's less room to move. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, smaller lot size, you have some flexibility because it's a minimum. And so, I mean, if you have a smaller one, then that either gives somebody the ability to make some lots small and some lots big, or gives them the ability to make them all small and put it into open space. But they're not going to get more density if you got a density limit.
That's right.
So having a lot size this big to where it maxes it out, it just encourages everybody to try and max out their lots and minimize the open space.
Mm-hmm. That's what I'm saying. Let's get control of this.
Yeah. I think we'd get support from a lot of people about that.
Well, I'm just listening to all of it. I like the idea of varied lot sizes because I don't like that cookie cutter like so many of them are, where you go in and all the driveways are exactly the same. I just don't know how to get away from that.
Well,
we
have
grab control of the issue.
Your numbers, I think, is one option.
Well, you know.
We've had success with it in the past.
You know, I will say there are a couple of things to consider. The future development map clearly has an overwhelming single character area across. That is a vision. Number two, we also have a historical precedence of what res 3 with a smaller lot size being something that gained popularity, and we certainly had a lot of rezonings. So there is a community character that's developed, and we also have a vision, and I'm not saying that we should not try to have variability, but I think you also have to look at it in terms of the recent context of the last 10 years and also our current vision for the next 20.
Well, and that res 3 requires sewer.
Yes.
For
right.
sewer mm-hmm. hookup, and
yes.
that was a big issue.
Yeah.
When
but
it came up.
With the population projections, you know, one could have endless discussions about when we were talking about doubling the population in the long range period, how that population will be accommodated through housing. And our comprehensive plan certainly is clear about the need for a variety of housing options to accommodate not just the numbers, but, you know, people of different ages and lifestyles. So. You know, whether that's a density question or so forth, you could say, okay, if we keep it at res 3, how are we going to accommodate the rise in population? And I think that also speaks to more housing choices.
So the reasoning for this was to make it where they could get that density with that square footage. That was the reason that this came up.
I can't say that staff was directed with the specific numbers. Now the conversations that took place and the calculations that took place is that I'm not sure we were given specific numbers at a work session.
And I agree with what Penny was saying. I'd rather appeal to a broader spectrum of developers. Would it be? And I appreciate y'all discussing this because I think it's good for the county, not personally. But is it out of line to say, well, you know, look into the alternative that we're talking about and maybe give us another idea, even if we have to.
We have to vote on this.
Even though we have to go and vote on this, that doesn't mean that we can't come up with something later.
We can always continue the discussion at future work sessions about performance standards.
Is that going to be a lot of work for nothing? I don't want to have you do a whole lot of work for nothing if we're not interested in it.
Just because it's not in this text also doesn't mean you couldn't send your ideas along to the Board of Commissioners. It doesn't have to be a final product they get from the Planning Commission.
Yeah.
You could say,
we're voting for this, or vote
for this with a change, but we're also suggesting you look into a CR1 type product that has an average lot size with a 9,000, maybe it's a 9,000 square foot minimum and a 14,000 square foot average or something.
And Vanessa could help with that between now and next week.
I don't know so much about that.
We'd have to hear if we heard a real clear message of what the Planning Commission wanted, we could come with a general bullet point.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, they could do it if that's what we want to do. I mean, this is just an idea that I'm floating, and I think it's a good idea. And Emily,
a staff prepared product. As much as my suggestion is, just keep in mind at that meeting, you're gonna have a public hearing, to hear from the public.
Mm-hmm.
After you've heard that input, if you have some suggestions, feel free to make them. Don't feel like it has to be a finished product that's ready to be sent to the printers.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Give you direction to the Board of Commissioners. That's what they have.
I personally couldn't come up with, because I haven't studied it. And that's why, if I was to bring it up at the meeting, like what you're talking, I would say, Vanessa, can you give us an overview of what we discussed in the work session as something we might possibly consider? That's not out of line there, is it?
It's not out of line, but at this point, I would tell you, I don't know what that means.
Yeah,
I don't know.
I think you would have to have some specifics.
You got to give us something. Yeah. We talked about so much.
The recommendation, it could either focus on a product type, but it could also focus on process, which means if the Planning Commission thought the recommendation needed to focus on the process to get the data, meaning maybe a stakeholder committee of some sort, or product type, which is a variable lot size type. I mean, I think you could focus on the process for change as much as you could on the product type. You might not know what the product type is right now, but you could advocate for input of more information from the development community.
Could it be a general idea of the product type?
Absolutely. I think it could be a combination. I just wanted to bring up the process part of it too.
Yeah.
So I guess we're at a good point. That's what I was trying to say. So we're at a point now that
I think we're in agreement that we need a more varied product. And I think we don't have the numbers or exactly.
Let me make a suggestion then that I don't necessarily have to be involved, because my involvement was to come up with this idea. Maybe you or you and Jane seems to be pretty, but either the two of y'all or the two of y'all might get together over the next week and come up with some kind of recommendation and let y'all.
I think Vanessa had a really good idea in that we need to focus on the process to get the data and to send that forward with that message.
And that's what I'm saying. I have a couple of commissioners.
Because then they can use this that we've been given, and then we can begin work on the process.
Yeah.
If they okay it. Is that?
I was just throwing it in as an adjunct.
No, I think it's a really good idea. I think it's a good idea.
I'm trying to say is let
a couple of people from the commission work. If you want to do it, that's fine too. Maybe a couple of people work, so we're not having a quorum. work with Vanessa between now and the next meeting so that we can throw something up again, do what Tom was saying, put something out there and let them know that we're thinking, you know, a little different. And but we don't even know exactly what to say right now, but y'all, I'm sure something could come up in a week, but that's just a thought.
I mean, I definitely think that, you know, the biggest thing is I think we need more information on that. But I definitely think that it's something that we do need to pursue. And it would be great, I don't know how we do it, especially the quorum issues and all, but it'd be great to be able to meet with the Board of Commissioners even and discuss like what I'd like to get more about their viewpoints versus with some of these ideas as well, and make sure that conversation is working.
We work so separately on things that are actually combined efforts.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
Yeah.
But we need to, what Tom was saying is at least put the Board of Commissioners on alert that we're down here monkeying around with this.
I think we can do that with a motion to just let them know that we're going to be looking for more data from staff.
Well, I think it'd be nice for somebody to make it work on it, whether y'all want to work on it with somebody. I'm not particularly that work.
I think we can work on it. I don't know that it's going to, I mean, we're not going to come up with a solution by next Tuesday.
No solution, you know? But come up with a motion.
We can definitely figure out a way to include our concerns.
Yeah, just come up with some kind of motion. Do you have a motion in your head already?
A recommendation for them.
I don't know one to run up. I mean, I'm trying to think. I think it would be nice to see, to get more feedback from not just people. I mean, even if you're talking about people in the development community, you know, you've got other people, like people that do the land planning for a lot of development products. Somebody, if we have products in mind that we think, you know, would like here, like in other places, what are those land planners, like who are they and what is it that they look for in ordinances, things like that. But that's all stuff that takes time and digging, and I don't know
we had a public hearing about it, and nobody came out to say anything.
I can make a motion to do that at the meeting next week. I'm just trying to say that I don't want to bulldoze through this thing, and I'm trying to open it up to, you know, to the whole
commission. Well, it's clear to me that the board wants more information and wants to give more input and change things up a bit. In the meantime, this has to be dealt with because of time constraints.
Okay, so, well, since we can't, I'll be glad to meet with Vanessa myself, even though I said I didn't. And then she can help give me some guidance on a motion. And then
I think just the wording of the motion is the main thing.
But if somebody else would prefer to do it.
We didn't say we weren't going to do it.
No, I know that. I'm just trying to get the wording. I mean, I don't know what the wording is.
I'm sure we can come up with something.
Okay, would you like to pick somebody to work with you, or do you want to do it by yourself?
I think it'll all get worked out.
Somebody will take care of it.
Is that fine with you, Tom? Is that fine with you, Vanessa?
We're available. Knock on our door. Call us up.
Listen, I think that we're becoming activists.
Okay, so I have a question about these. If we're done talking, are you done?
I just wanted to mention one thing about this, is that if that's the case, though, and there's something that's time sensitive, it seems like to me the whole thing is driving this from talking about, you know, just with different folks in the development side, that there's concerns because the 14.5 isn't matching up with the 2.5, and that's kind of what has driven a lot of the discussion about this. So instead of toying around with Res 4, and this is just because people are coming in at Res 4 with densities lower than what Res 3 is, and that's not what this, I don't think that that's what anybody intended for us to do. It's just the way that right now it's a really popular product that they tend to be around 11,000 square feet, and they want a lower density, and but they have the wider lots. And so my thought was, in the short term, if something is going to pass, instead of trying to make a bunch of changes right now, do the minimum change. If the only thing that they need is to change that square footage and the density isn't going to change, then why not just change the square footage if something's got to pass quickly so that not everything's coming in as res 4, and then us include in that motion that we're going to reevaluate
the densities
overall.
I mean, you hit the nail on the head. And that's what, you know, maybe y'all could come up with a motion that would, or somebody can, you know. Mm-hmm. I know I could. I could sit down with Vanessa and come up with a motion in an hour or two. Mm-hmm. But I'm trying to say I'll back off and let you or a couple of you.
So is that where we're at with this then?
So it'll happen somehow. Somebody's going.
You okay?
Yep.
I kind of think Jane.
Okay, here's my question. My question is, when we have to vote on these in the meeting, again, are we going to have to vote on these all separately, or can we take the ones that there are no issues with and lump those together in one group and do one motion, and then the ones that have added wordage or whatever, do those separately rather than doing all five of them separately with separate motions? How would you prefer that we handle this?
However you're most comfortable is the answer, I would say.
Just the answer you didn't want.
So, yeah.
All right.
Can we say
there's no problem breaking it into pieces.
We like to make a motion that we'd like to approve or send to the board for approval A, D, and
Absolutely.
Then just pick those and then say, and then do a different motion for B and then a different motion.
I think that makes a lot of sense because right now we've just discussed B and D as the ones you.
Yeah, there. I think there's only two that we have issues with that we're concerned about. Okay.
That's fine.
Yeah, and Mr. Fricky won't have a problem with that, you think, will he?
No.
Okay.
So you could
make sure that you didn't have a problem with that, right?
You know what? We just need
to be clear what it is we're sending out. And as long as we accomplish that, it doesn't matter if it's all at once, each one by itself, or two and three, three and two.
Okay. Would we need to put at the end of this, since we're changing, probably would be changing the wordage, anything in there about having it okay by staff or okay by the attorney, or do we need to worry about any of that?
No. If you make some kind of recommendation for a change and we thought there was a problem, that's our job to notify the board of that.
Okay.
Yeah. And all we're doing is back a recommendation. So we got a little bit more clout than we thought we had.
I have one more quick question about variances, on the administrative variances. And the reason I was thinking about that, I know that a lot of the recommendations came from residential development side. Are there any office, industrial, or commercial variances that are sought really frequently that make the process cumbersome, where the administrative variance process would apply to those? Or is it really just a residential?
That's a great question.
The buffers, you know,
we've got setbacks covered.
Yeah.
And we've got buffers on the list, Vanessa?
Yeah, just specific things like Georgia 400 buffer. So much of it doesn't apply.
There's nothing after setbacks.
Okay.
Most of what goes to the zoning board of appeals is typically a residential product.
Okay.
Agricultural. So not much commercial or industrial.
The 400 buffer is the only thing that comes to mind as being something, but again, okay. That's still limited. I'll say limited area.
Right. Okay. Trying to think about.
I think it'd be a good move from that and not cut off the standard
room.
Or something we could streamline there as well.
I don't know if there's parking or building height requirements or anything like that.
Building height is one of the
because
ones.
Of the front.
Well, that is one of the things on the list was building height.
Okay. I guess that would apply across. Yeah. Signage? I don't know if signage is it.
We don't do variances to signs.
Oh, okay.
We don't want the ZBA or the board deciding whose speech is more important than us.
Yeah.
So we just say there's no variances to signs.
That's a good call.
Well, once again, I just want to thank the board for humoring me and discussing it. And I think it worked out.
Any more questions on this section of the UDC? We're all good? Okay. Moving on. Review and discussion of applications from the May 28th, 2013 public hearing. CP120006, Michael Clements, postponed from May 28th.
He withdrew this afternoon.
He withdrew this afternoon?
Yes, he did.
Which one was that?
The Senior Housing. The senior, the assisted living.
Supposedly withdrew without prejudice.
Yes, yeah, I will be processing it tomorrow, I came in this afternoon.
Okay, that withdrew.
Yes.
ZA 36-23-88 Davis Creek LLC. Is there any discussion about this?
Should we just go on and move on to three? That's the joke.
Have you heard anything on it? Discussing it?
Anything new? Anybody heard anything new?
I've been hearing a lot about screams and stuff. I've just been hearing about that. You've been working on it, I think, a little bit more, so, you know, I think that, my personal opinion is I think pretty much people have decided, I mean, commissioners are comfortable with their decisions. Any more discussion, not going to do a whole lot of good, except for, which other side of the fence?
But anybody got anything? Craig, do you have anything?
I mean, what I've been working on is a RES 4 with a density of 3.
I think there was one issue that that was brought up to me that I had not thought about at all until it was mentioned, and that was, what if the quarry expanded and became not mining, but if they expanded, then these folks would be right next to the quarry, and then, you know, further than they are. They're, and my thought process is a development would be better than having the quarry next to these people. If I were living there, I would rather have a development next to me than the quarry.
You're saying the people that are already there.
The right. People that are already there. The, primarily the people who live, I guess, on Vicky Lane, because that's that. Now there's,
well, I think,
you know, there's a stream that separates the property behind Vicky Lane from a part of portion of this property that's being that's asking for the rezoning. And that stream and the buffer and everything separates them quite a bit. I looked back at some old zonings from 2007 where there were two pieces of property on Vicky Lane that were rezoned to Res 3. And they have stipulated in there that, and it, I mean, it was abutting one of the residents of Vicky Lane, so it was a little bit different situation than what this is. But they not only wanted their homeowners association or their realtor, whoever sells the lots, to notify people buying about the quarry, but also about a dog kennel that's on Vicky Lane.
But we're not worried. I mean,
we're not worried about that.
About
but
that.
No, yeah. But as part of the development, you know, with conditions and everything else, when you start doing stuff like that, I think you need to look at things like that as well, because we do condition that.
Right.
But at the same
because
time,
because they have to do.
You don't want to outsmart the develop. I mean, you don't want to say. I mean, we've heard from those people over there. They made it pretty clear to me, and I don't think that I know more about it than they do,
mm-hmm.
You know. So I'm not going to sit up here and dictate and say, I know you said what you said, but I really think.
What do you think is the appropriate use?
don't know. I mean, I'm gonna float this. And we discussed this a little bit. I'm gonna say two things. One, it takes a little while to come up with a sketch plat. You don't come up with that within a few hours, I don't think.
Okay.
But yet we were presented with a sketch plat.
But that's water underneath the bridge. What do you think is an appropriate use?
I'm kind of thinking that, and I don't know if you discussed it, some kind of a split zoning or something that might appeal to everybody. In other words, the property is close to the...
Yeah, they're talking about doing bigger lots against the...
Yeah, that's what... So maybe you and Todd or whoever, you know, maybe y'all can think... I'm answering your question.
So we're looking at... I mean, right now, technically, we're looking at the Res 6, but there's a...
We can come up with whatever we want.
I'm just saying. There is an idea out there for Res 4.
Right.
Would it be helpful to us to look at the lot size on the Res 4 as opposed to 6,000 going up in lot size to help with your concern of not having, you know,
well, my
too small.
Concern is, I was listening to the residents.
Of course, all of our concerns.
Yeah, and I'm also, you know, the developers have a right to get a rezone. Are you trying to make a Res 4 into a Res 3? I mean, I'm not, with all due respect, I mean...
Well, you can't make a Res 4 into a Res 3 because the lot size of a Res 3 is 14,500 square feet, and there's no possible way that they could put the number of units on that property at the 4,500.
But you want to limit, so, I mean, this might be above my pay grade.
Okay.
But when you say Res 4 with a limit of 3.
Right.
What do you think about three houses per...
But our Res 3 is at 2.5.
I know that.
So it's not a Res 3, it's a Res 4.
That's right. But you just gave me an argument a while ago that you can't do 3 lots per acre. I mean, when I was saying Res 3 will be Res 3,
and you said you can't... No, that's not what I said at all.
Well, maybe I must have misunderstood, but...
This is a whole different situation. Right now we're talking about a Res 4 with
three.
Right now it's at 6,000 square foot lot size minimum and 3.0 density. Mm-hmm. That's completely feasible.
Okay.
I mean, I can calculate it for you.
I'm in agreement.
I'm becoming an expert at the calculator.
The other thing they ask y'all about is, you know, they were concerned about one entrance.
Yeah.
Yes.
And if you look at that situation, if you make two entrances on Vicky Lane, you're going to create a bigger problem than one entrance, I believe.
So at 3.0 density, using 60% of your land for lots, you get 8,712 square feet per lot as a maximum possibility.
Uh-huh. And over there, there's a lot of hills and valleys.
But that's taking into consideration that you're only using 60% of the land. Okay. That takes into consideration
the
floodplain and all those things.
Mm-hmm.
It's a average across the board. So what I'm saying is, what if we looked at, instead of a 6,000 square foot minimum, do like a 7,000 square foot minimum to up the lot size, keep the density the same,
mm-hmm.
and then try to work with everybody.
Yeah.
I'm just asking what you think.
Oh, I'm not hardcore.
That's something to think about.
Yeah.
Seems feasible considering that if you, the numbers say 8,712.
Right.
So at 7,000, you're still giving them flexibility, I would think.
And they're talking about doing larger lots mm-hmm. on the Vicky Lane
right.
side.
So and maybe you could put that in there. That's to answer your question. Yeah, I'm still kind of stuck on Res 3, but I'm not closed-minded about it. And and it is partially in my district, even though, but majority of it's in
So your motion before was a res 3 to 2.2?
Yeah.
Right.
I'm kind of stuck on that. You know, if you come up with something better, which it sounds like y'all are working on, and...
Well, back to the entrance, I went out there and just sat on the end of Vicky Lane for about 15 minutes, just so I could look and see what was what everywhere. And I'm with you. I don't see any way that they could do two entrances. It would be impossible and dangerous, much more dangerous than the way things are now. Even with a rivalry across the road, it would make it...
At a 2.2,
horrible.
The lot sizes would have to be, which is not in a res 3. It's impossible.
Listen, that if we don't touch two entrances,
I think that was just something that the residents, giving you
I'm leaving
it was traffic concerns.
I don't think there's going to be a lot of traffic. I didn't see an issue with
gas. But I think the traffic issues are coming from the Windermere people, because I believe that the Windermere folks use Dave's Creek as a cut through.
I'm just curious, they're working on that intersection.
And he's the one that caught the flag.
I wondered about that too, because there are murals and work going on.
Lane?
It's Dave's Creek and
Dave's Creek and
Old Atlanta.
There's work going on.
They were talking about trying to move that down at one time.
That's what I was wondering
Completely moving it. I don't know if they're completely moving it. They might just be making improvements.
Shoulder improvements or something.
I guess the bottom line of what I'm saying is that it looked like Alvin and I were kind of holding the line on Res 3 the other night. Speaking for myself, I think that some of the stuff that you're doing has a lot of merit, and you make a motion and see how it flies. My recommendation, for what it's worth, is to possibly consider doing a split zoning, to make sure it gets. But at the same time, if that doesn't make sense to you, then I can understand that. So. I'm not making my mind up until I hear what you're going to say.
What did you ask?
It could be conditioned with percentages. So the percentage, you could do a 20% of lots are going to be a certain size, 40% of lots are going to be a certain size.
But that's
see what
not,
I'm saying?
Yeah, that was in that 2007. I know it's a different zoning that I looked
like,
at.
Like
they had done some percentages like that.
Well, and you can stipulate that.
Right.
I mean, you can condition that. You can condition that the lots abutting Vicky Lane are going to be, 14,500 square feet, and the rest of the lots are going to be an average of something else. I mean, that's part of what you can do.
Right. Is that a development I was trying to figure out, could you call out, for lots abutting, would you have to, I guess, call out each of those individual tax parcels? They're only five or six.
Yeah.
But you could set a minimum lot size for lots abutting that. I've tried to figure out.
Cautious with the wording.
Proposed
lots adjacent to the lots that access Vicky Lane, not Vicky Lane itself. And I'd probably recommend a distance as well, say adjacent. Because if there's a 5 foot wide open space, then there's an argument that they're not adjacent to it. So maybe lots within 100 feet of this property line.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever gets right down to it, ripping the page out of your book and drawing a red line on it, putting it on the screen and saying, this is the area I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
We can send that on if we have to.
Yeah, I've not seen that done, but that's pretty smart.
Are there any details on the product that they're looking to build? I guess the reason why I was curious about if there's any detail on the product would it even be more advantageous to do Res 6 at 3 units an acre, just so that way there's more room for open space, mainly because I feel like the more forest you have that remains, the better. I mean, even if you increase the buffers on all the adjoining properties, but the more buffer you have between the mining operation and any residential, the better off. And the more buffer you have over here is going to help everybody farther away too.
But I don't know if there's an issue with product, the type of product that was coming out of Res 6. It seems like that's some people's concerns. Even if Res 3, there's no more impact on traffic and anything like that.
It's also the product. Mm-hmm. So not looking, I mean, I don't think the residents are looking for that.
Yeah.
It's also, you know, you're gonna hear from people who are just scared about Res 6 showing up on the zone.
That's a problem.
Well, that's, yeah, I mean, that's the issue we have in Res 4, and you got lots of density of Res 2. It's just the name.
Res 4. There's lots of names. So,
although that is hard to make that a basis for zoning.
Of course, I mean, yeah. I'm not advocating any of that.
So is that all the discussion on the Dave's Creek? Responding to public outburst at a public meeting. I should do this.
You're welcome to.
Please. That's what I did.
Well, last month's meeting, I left telling like staff we had obviously missed an item we should have covered when we had that training a month before then. And I can tell you this topic is on my list now to talk about annually with the Planning Commission. Because what I saw last month was just we'd gone through a very long period not having hardly anything on our agenda. And if it was, a lot of times it was maybe something going back to A1. And so we had a pretty easy run as far as contentious meetings. And then we got hit with one. It was one of the toughest ones I'd seen in over a decade. And Washington, I felt like, yeah, we hadn't prepared the Planning Commission for this, and I felt bad that we put you in that position, so I apologize for that. And what I wanted to talk today about was, I'm going to tell you the things you already know, but I'm going to talk about why we want to control that type of response from the audience, and then a suggestion I have, how we might accomplish it, but it's definitely up to the Planning Commission on how we want to accomplish it, and if we can think of something better, I would love to hear any suggestions from you as well. So the first thing is, you know, why do we want to do this? And it's three main reasons. The first is just a matter of respect. You have five members of the community spending their time, dedicating their time to being on the Planning Commission. You deserve better than being yelled at and called names. The people in the audience who are there for other cases deserve better. And having to sit there and listen to that and have, they might be item 15 on the agenda and have to spend all that extra time, maybe just to be at home with their families as well, to a meeting that's moving very slowly because of continued outburst and continually having to tell people to please hold those kinds of comments. It's also that as a Planning Commission, we have a responsibility to make a level playing field. So what you can never say what happened for sure, but what could have happened last month is there could have been someone in the audience who felt like, boy, I came to speak in favor of this Res 6 application, but I don't want to go up there and talk about that now and be called names. Maybe they're going to follow me out in the parking lot and keep my car. This is crazy. So for the applicant, for anyone wishing to share their views, we want to make a welcome environment for them to do that and have a level playing field. The final thing that hurts us if we have that kind of outburst is the outburst naturally happens at the cases that have a lot of different opinions. And those are also the cases that will often end up in court. And if they end up in court and whoever's representing the person who's unhappy comes and says, let me play you a tape of the meeting. Coward, who do you work for? Mm-hmm. Boos, hisses, whistling. What they're saying is, this is what the decision was based on. Mm-hmm. They were bullied. It wasn't based on planning. It wasn't based on land use or the comprehensive plan. It was based on being bullied by a mob. We don't want to do that. We want to make Ken Girard's job easy if he ever has to go to court for us. And let him argue the merits of
UDC and the comp plan and not get dragged into, did the Planning Commission get influenced by a vocal group of people who came to the meeting? So that's why we want to do it. A minor suggestion related to it all is, I'd like you, and I'd suggest that you focus on applause as well, not just people yelling, but you'll have sometimes where someone gets up and makes a point a lot of people agree with, and if they happen to have a crowd there, all of a sudden it's a round of applause. That, I think, my suggestion is, when you hear that applause, treat it just the same as you treat yelling. Because if not, it sends the message to people that this is how the meeting works. This is how it's appropriate for me to make these kinds of remarks and show my pleasure or my dislike of what's happening. So I'd say, as we talk about how we want to approach it, think about applause just the same as you think about vocal comments. Okay. How we wanted to go about it. I'm going to run you through my suggestion and hear what you have. The first is the staff, the first level. I see four levels. The first level is the staff always start the meeting and we read that statement. Please, you know, we'd love for you to participate at the right time. Please don't have general outburst. So right at the start of the meeting, we tell everyone the rules for the game. As soon as you have an outburst during the meeting, I'd suggest that you immediately address it. Most likely this could come from the chair. The burden falls on you, it's ideally on you. Make sure at the start of the meeting we've got that gavel up there and use it.
Okay.
And let people know the first time it happens. I would suggest just keeping it short and brief. That's unacceptable. And if we want to try to, we could have a written type of statement you could read, but I think it looks best if you just think about it some and not that you're reading it, but that you're comfortable saying something quick about. We want everyone to feel welcome here speaking. We don't allow those kind of outbursts. Consider this a warning. If it happens again, then I suggest you do a similar type of warning, but step it up a notch. Stop the discussion that's taking place. Provide a warning. Make it clear that notify the people that upon the next warning, they will be ejected from the meeting. And then if someone was speaking during that time frame, particularly the side on the other side, I would suggest either adding or resetting the clock if they had been interrupted while they were speaking. If you have another outburst, yes, Jody?
Well, go ahead.
If you have another outburst, stop the meeting. At this point, I'd recommend you are asking someone to leave the meeting. Identify that person. You can ask me, Tom, the person there, will you please ask them to leave and walk them out of the building? I think we're not dealing with a drunken bar scene here. I don't think we need bouncers and armed guards or anything like that. Whoever you point out specific, I'll walk up to that person and notify them they have to leave the meeting.
Okay.
If they are unwilling to leave the meeting, I'll go back on the microphone. I'll inform you that they're unwilling to leave the meeting. And I'll ask you to take a 15-minute recess while the sheriff comes and escorts them out of the meeting.
Okay.
Again, with that one, reset the clock however is appropriate if it came up during someone's opportunity to speak. Now, we can mess with the edges of it a little, fine-tune it, but that's a general approach I think we need to be ready to implement, and we gotta stick to it and really let people know we're serious about it.
The only thing, I guess the word question is on the second warning. Yes. Would it be proper or okay for the chairman to ask for a vote of the rest of us, which would basically be letting, if we took a vote and we all backed up the chairman, that would send a message that we're not going to put up with this. You know, we're unified in what she's saying. It's not just Pam saying it, the whole board is
voting that the next outburst will result in an ejection.
Uh-huh. Something like that. Basically, all I'm trying to say is support, let the people out there know that the whole commission is in support of what Pam is saying. It's not just Pam saying it. And I think it, that might carry some weight. And it would give her a little cover, too. Just, that's just a thought.
Both options are equal to me, so whatever you're, the planning commission is more comfortable with, I can do. You can do.
But at the same time, it'd be my, if you had a break in the ranks on that, that wouldn't be good. You know, but I don't think we would.
Well, I think
suggests that it's up for discussion.
Right. So, if we just keep it, this is the way that we conduct a meeting and that's it, then you have no choice. And we should, I mean, we should always back up Pam in that situation. You know, I mean, people will know that we're unified if we just keep it that way instead of...
Keep it.
I'm saying if we stick to what Tom's saying and make it a...
Yeah,
every
without,
meeting
without voting.
Without voting, because every meeting would have the same outcome. I mean, we'd all be doing the same thing every
so
single
you're
meeting.
Saying two warnings, not just one warning, but two.
Yeah.
Is that what judges generally do in a courtroom? Do they normally do a, I mean, I'm thinking back, it looks to me like that's about what they do. I mean, they put up with a little bit. And they let them know they don't. I think it sounds fairly reasonable. But at the same time, you're given, that's like three strikes and you're out rather than two. And it just depends on what you want, you know, what you're comfortable.
My thought is you get a real quick warning, we don't do it. The second one, a warning, get ready for ejection. The next thing is going to be ejection. Mm-hmm. That makes the meeting, as soon as you say that, you know, It's fair, and it's what we need to do.
Yeah.
But it also sets a certain tone.
Yeah. That, I think you would only have to do it once because...
So I was trying to avoid having to say, use the word being ejected.
Yeah.
Or however we want to say, being removed.
Removed.
So I can say that. You know, some people are going to be concerned about that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they're, you know, some people aren't going to understand all the issues behind it while we're doing it, and they're going to be put off. So we're trying to see that our best if we could avoid it.
Mm-hmm.
But
once again, I mean, I understand what everybody's saying, but if we all backed her up, maybe not with a vote, but maybe with a nod of the head or something, I think it gives credibility, and it doesn't pit that person against Pam. Mm-hmm. It pits that person against all of us. And they may not realize that if Pam is the point. So maybe there's a different way than voting that...
you can get on the microphone, you know, if you want to just get on the microphone and say, thank you, Pam, for I agree entirely.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Something quick like that.
Okay.
That's a good idea.
Yeah, that's the whole idea. Well, that's good. Keep voting. And
well, that's a lot better than me talking to them like I did my children when they were 2 and 3 years old, like I did during the meeting.
Yeah.
So...
I don't mind speaking up, you don't know that. I don't mind speaking up and supporting that. And if that doesn't look like it's enough, then somebody else chime in.
Well, I think we're all
in a situation
that we all will.
Yeah, I think everybody will. And I think that everybody was upset about the outburst and the treatment, the lack of respect.
I think
all
really
of us were upset about that.
Because then they realize they're dealing with all of us. Which they are.
We weren't prepared for it. We didn't know what to expect.
And it keeps it from being a personal thing.
Now we thought.
Yeah.
Lesson learned.
Okay. Right.
Now, the last thing I would say is keep in mind there'll be certain response. You might have a response one day so extreme that you say, that's it. You are out of the meeting.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
Someone gets up to that podium and unloads a long list of profanities at you.
Yeah, that's it.
Looks like there's some kind of physical threat to the room. Just
or
right
is disrespectful to someone else in the audience that would be threatening to them.
That's enough right there.
Yeah.
You don't need two or three warnings.
Sure. So you're saying disrespect to the warning. I mean, if somebody makes a statement back as soon as you warn them?
Yeah.
Yes.
We'll sit down another reason with them.
That's good, Tom. Thank you for that.
Thank you.
Well, let us know how we can help.
We'll find out.
We'll continue to make our generic introduction statement. Play it from there.
And the four?
Meeting room setup.
Meeting room setup. Well, this is something Vanessa and I were talking about from one issue, but then since our last meeting, we had something else come up that even is probably more important now, is that Teresa has, she's retired. Her last day is end of this month or start of next month.
July 3rd.
July 3rd. So Vanessa and I, we're going to be bringing someone new on staff, and who exactly, I'll most likely still be at the Planning Commission. Vanessa will be here for a while. Teresa was very good at picking out who made a motion on the slightest little sound, and she knew who said it and could write it down. The last meeting when Teresa wasn't there, Vanessa and I were there, we would ask her to keep turning to me, who made that motion? Mm-hmm. And my notes would say, a guy. So we would have to go back to the tape.
And the video didn't necessarily help.
Sometimes the video doesn't help. So just a general plea is, as you're speaking during the meetings, make sure you get on those microphones, get close to them. If you're making motions or a second, try your best really to get in that microphone and make a nice clear statement. It doesn't have to be long, but just, you know, second. If you raise your head, it even helps. And when we're raising hands to vote, we talked about, Vanessa looked into, could we use the Board of Commissioners, their voting button things, and it has their names up there rather than their districts, which is one challenge. And started asking about, could we swap out names, and it sounded like, the response we got was, well, that thing is old and it's handmade, and we're afraid it might fall apart if we mess with it too much. Vanessa and I can do fine with hands. Raising high, we're some members, we're kind of at a funny angle. Yeah. Craig, sometimes, you know, you might, where I sit, Jane's directly between you and I. So if you raise your hands, give us a good high raise, hold it there for at least a second or two before we can see it.
Do you want me to repeat who does the second? The name?
No, I don't want to put that burden on you. I don't think
that's a good
you
idea,
need to
though.
Do that. If you're comfortable with it, I'll take it.
I'll try.
But what we can do also, what we plan, is just to speak up. When we don't catch one, we're also comfortable getting on the microphone and saying, mm-hmm. Catch us up, please. Yeah. Who made that second?
Yeah. Yes.
And we can do that once or twice a night rather than every single vote.
Right.
Slowing down the meeting and putting an extra responsibility on you of saying.
I don't think it would hurt any of our feelings for you to say speak up.
No, and you know, and sometimes just, Vanessa's walking back from the podium after talking about the UDC, and I'm on the computer taking down the audio visual, and a motion is made to close the public hearing, and just. We might just ask you to repeat it.
Okay.
See, we can ask you to repeat it, get it down, and get it done in a matter of seconds rather than having to go through a tape and spend 3 hours the next day watching a tape. We're just going to ask you that stuff. So,
okay.
Get on the mics, raise your hands high.
Okay.
And I think we're also going to look into the name tags that are up there. We're going to talk to the Board of Commissioners about. Right now, you have your commissioner's name tag.
Their name tag and ours.
The front of the desk. Mm-hmm. Yours sits on top.
Well, we're not lined up with our commissioner either.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not by district.
So we're going to start. I can't make any promises there, but we want to talk upstairs about, could we get new name tags for at the meeting? There's just one. It's large enough for you can actually read it, and you slide in and out for whoever's mm-hmm. actually at the meeting. As a commissioner, I think I'd prefer that. You have all these different boards using that room, and people, you know, sitting in your seat with your name saying things you may or may not have.
Yeah, right.
So I bet we might get some support behind that. That's another thing we'll be working on in the future.
Okay.
That was it.
Anybody have any questions for Tom about that? No?
That's good. Thanks.
This is not on the agenda, but I'm going to tell you all this. If you noticed last time when we started the meeting and did the Pledge of Allegiance, I asked Jane to lead us in the pledge. I'm going to do that each time, but I'm going in order. Like, I was first, she was second, you're next, and then you'll be next, and then you'll be next for the meetings. I'm going to alter it so that we each lead the pledge.
So all we have to remember is I pledge. And then everything goes from there.
I think you got it right.
And I'll come to you ahead of time.
That's what I asked. I was like,
I'll come to you ahead of time and tell you when it's your night.
Oh, that's good.
Won't be a surprise. Okay, I just wanted to throw that in. Number five, review and discussion of applications scheduled for public hearing on June 25th. A, CP130003, Grace Fellowship of South Forsyth. I have one question. Is this District 1 or District 3?
It's 2.
What?
So it's 2 in the book, right?
No, it's 3.
Oh, I'm looking at the Grace Fellowship.
Yeah, that's what I was.
There's 3 in the book.
Where does it say 2?
It says right here. It says 2. Planning Commission.
Okay, so it says,
oh, yeah,
2 and 3 is 1.
Oh, there's on the public participation plan.
So I will allow sitting now.
Okay. Just so we're, okay. Just so we know.
Let's see if I can find something right now on that too.
I know that map has tripped us up before when they changed it. Yeah, see on the front page, yeah. It has 1, and then on the actual staff report, it has 3. So that was.
And then in there.
Got 3.
In this, it says 2.
Yeah. Okay.
We're all over the map.
1, 2, 3.
Other than that.
Alan and I are.
Has anyone heard anything about this from the applicant or opposition, or has anybody gotten emails, anything at all?
I have not. I do have a couple of questions on it, though.
Okay.
For the variance to the septic for the sewer?
Yes.
3. 3?
Yeah.
This Ronald Reagan just... Northwest of Brandon, that's what I'm talking about.
Okay.
District 3.
Okay. So, the my question is about the variance to the sewer.
Mm-hmm.
Is the variance, once we do the variance, does that mean that even if they don't do a church, say somebody comes in and does something else, does the variance stick to the with the property? So if we do a variance for sewer and something that's going to use more than what we think is doable with the septic tank, then are we stuck with the sewer variance?
That's a good point, and I think that's a good concern. I would suggest you change the wording of the variance to include for the. Somehow identify that it's for the use proposed.
Okay.
And I had one of these one time that was going to do a school. It was a church. And I ended up conditioning it where when they got ready, that the variance to the sewer was fine while it was a church. But when they got ready to do the school, then the stipulation was is that they would hook up the sewer before they could do the school.
I remember that.
But this does say proposed use is a church with daycare and school.
Mm-hmm. But that
so
way,
do we
too,
know if they're doing the school right away or they're not?
But that way, they know that they have to save up that money before they do the school. And no, I do not know the answer to that. So hopefully in the public hearing we'll find that out.
Greg, have you heard anything?
No, I haven't.
Do you know where the sewer is at that they're looking for?
Well, see, the problem is that it's...
They have to do a pump station,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, they have to do a...
Because you don't even need a variance if you're doing gravity, do you? I mean, if you can't do gravity.
That's correct. Let's see.
So then...
Where's maybe gravity is 8,000 feet away in the vicinity of Long Lake Subdivision. There's sewer approximately 2,500 feet away near the entrance of South Forsyth High School. However, a pump station will be required.
Yeah. And pump stations, how much do they cost? Like $750,000 or something? I mean, it's...
expensive, and the county doesn't really want to take those out long term and have a bunch of those to maintain. Alan, let me talk to Water and Sewer between now and the meeting to find out why you're asking for that variance, because I agree with you. The distance is set on gravity, and it says right in the comments that gravity is 8,000 feet away, so.
Okay.
I'm not sure.
Did they actually condition it, or was that just a comment? If it wasn't a staff condition, I guess I could look at staff analysis. And
well, it was just Water and Sewer's comments.
So if this are comments, it's not really a condition that, well, I guess they wouldn't make a condition for it. So yeah, it just seems like that maybe there's not one needed. The variance isn't needed.
I wonder if they're anticipating, it could be that they're anticipating sewer being in that area by the time they this might be a 10-year plan. Mm-hmm. They might be anticipating sewers in the area 6 years from now when they get around to the school or the daycare.
Yeah, because typically they'll do the church first and the school comes later.
That might be the answer, but let me verify that for you by next week.
Okay. They've kind of doubted sewer would ever come up to that because of the lake downstream. Somebody have to go around that lake to the sewer. Maybe to the north of it, but okay.
The next is, are we done talking about that one? Everybody? ZA3604 Brecht Stables, is that the way to pronounce that? Is it like a Brecht? K or a CH or Brecht? Does anybody know?
Brecht? This is where Teresa's already being mentioned. I ask her tomorrow. You know.
Right. Anybody heard anything about this one?
Yeah, I've spoken to both Ethan and to Sonia Bush about it.
Uh-huh.
I know there's everybody around the property, I think in here, there's support letters.
Mm-hmm.
This is most of the people were in support of it. And I think the main reason why is because around most of it, there is it's either wooded or else it's just facing the pasture.
Mm-hmm.
And most of those uses are residential. Mm-hmm. There is one parcel which is on, I can't read that red name on here. Let's see.
Riley Road or Pathway Road?
Riley, yes. Riley, that parcel extends to Riley, and that's where there's a stable.
Mm-hmm, that's where the stable is.
I
went into their driveway.
Okay, yeah. So that's, that's the main concern, is that there's a fairly intense use there. There's not a lot of separation from the lot to the north, mm-hmm. which is where Sonia Bush and them live. And, you know, right now, I think up to this point, most everybody has been parking up there along that driveway. So everybody's, if people are parking up here and their kids are down in this main area, these people are just sitting there right next to their yard. So that's been being used fairly intensely, and that does cause some concerns. So I believe right now there's conditions that activity would have to move over to Concord Road.
Right.
And that's what's driving that move over there.
And
that's where
they'd all be coming
in
and out from Concord too, not Riley in the driveway.
Right. So that use, there should not be any sort of commercial type of.
And that would be that would remain as a residential their home. Is that correct?
It would be residential. My understanding is it would still have the cub because the stables would be used. Now the stable is for boarding. The stables do have three stalls, and there's more horses, so I don't exactly know what the operation would be, but obviously all the horses can't be up there. Most of the time horses are going to be down in the pasture anyway, but I don't know if they probably, I'm guessing they might have to carry them up there to get them ready or something like that.
But they're obviously having to pull them up there right now. It's not that big a deal for them to go back down. And there's other concerns about just the horses in here, not knowing where the horses are from, making sure that they're separated because the bushes do have a horse right there, and trying to keep some sort of separation. I think that
is there a fence all the way around this?
There is a fence around the perimeter of it. You know, that would mean that the two horses could come in contact, and there is a buffer that we're getting a variance on. So in that area. And the possibility of maybe leaving a buffer in that area so that the where the activities were occurring and where the stable is going to be, that area is screened from the bush residents since that is going to be part of the cup.
This is your district, isn't it?
It is. I think that's.
When you talk about a buffer, are you talking about plantings or fences? Because horses, you know, a lot of things are poisonous to horses and their stomachs are very sensitive. Having had horses, I can vouch for that.
Sure. I know that the main thing on the back part, my understanding was the main thing against the rear is just the idea of having the separation is more important than screening because there is just pasture. Mm-hmm. But on the side where the house is, the horses aren't getting up in that area. Mm-hmm. That's outside of the fence. It's like what, right when you drive out the driveway.
Here.
So that area, right, so that area would be a screen fence and potentially a, let's see, is that right?
No,
I'm sorry.
On the other side.
This is no, yeah.
So you're basically talking about a double fence, about 6 feet apart or something like that? Is that
well, up here, this is just screen fence. Back here, this is pasture.
Yeah.
But up here, this is where there's a house and there's a stable. So this would be the area where potentially using like a screen fence. Mm-hmm. There's a screen fence up there. It needs some work, I believe. It talked about just if you put in the conditions that it has to be maintained opaque so that way it's going to be solid all the way across. Mm-hmm. Because there were concerns. There's a fence up right now, but it does have a few gaps in it.
Mm-hmm.
And then potentially if you put vegetation in there as well, in that area.
If the barn is here, are there stipulations of spreading the manure when they muck the stalls out in the pasture?
There,
can you make that a condition? I mean, as I'm thinking about this out loud, can you make that as a condition?
Sure could. My ability to enforce it would be, I'm not saying
it would be complaint driven, probably, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would be complaint driven, and it's one of those things that are hard to catch, hard to prove, but not.
That is an issue, though. I mean, for, like I say, I mean, I had horses, and you have to do something with the, when you clean the stalls, you have to do it, and you don't want to have just a big pile.
Well, no, yeah, there was a pile over here, so that's one concern, is there a way to spread that, or is there a way to put a note about the fact that it can't be piled up to the point that it's a nuisance, or you know, mm-hmm. creating flies everywhere. I'm not exactly sure what the wording would be for that, but I do think that's a good suggestion.
Yeah, I think that's a good suggestion.
Your suggestion, yeah, there you go.
It's a good suggestion.
Well,
that was
you know,
a concern.
Because flies are a concern. And I realize that the condition like that is hard to, but still,
it's,
that's a concern.
A problem. If any way you can word it to make it easier to enforce, then it's more likely we can keep everyone happy in the future as well.
Okay. I do know that. There's been ongoing discussions, I think, and hopefully at the hearing there'll at least be some support or some agreement on what those conditions should be more specific. But those were concerns. I mean, you know, biggest concerns I saw there.
So, Alan, am I understanding that you're thinking of adding additional conditions over and above the staff? conditions about the vegetated buffer?
Potentially, yes.
Okay. I just, of course, want to make sure that I get an wording at the end of the meeting for any additional conditions that might be.
I'll put it in. I'll make sure that we have everything in writing.
Yeah, I'm guessing that with Teresa being dumb, it's really important that we're really, really careful about things like that. Write it down as we're making our motion, you know, in the meeting, so that we can give it to staff so that they actually have it that way.
I'll be using, you know, of course, Teresa is showing me the details of how she would, you know, handle meetings and applications and so forth. And we do have, you know, a scorecard, you know, templates that we use to write down, you know, who makes the motion and what happens with each application. But it would be very helpful as new wording is added or new conditions that we get back to get that by the end of the meeting.
Okay.
The minutes.
Any other discussion about this? No? Number C is ZA 3626, Linda and Harold Gravitt. Anybody heard anything about this one? I haven't. It's in my district. Well, this is basically they're going CBD on Highway 20. And there's CBD next to them.
And it's in line with the comprehensive
plan. I went in their driveway too. Do they have a variance request? No. Anybody have any comments other than me mumbling down here? D is ZA 3627, Mike and Liz Sosebee. This is District 3. Oh, this is where the logs are, right? Where there's the log, where they're selling firewood. I didn't have to go in their driveway. I went to AutoZone instead and parked.
Anybody here heard anything?
I think it's gonna. Most of it really, I think, it's going to improve the property.
CBD all around it.
Yeah, it's CBD all around it.
Yeah, once they get, assuming they get zoned, they'll be required to actually properly develop. To get a site development permit.
Which is not that way.
Put it in a parking lot. Put it in landscape. Maybe buffers. Get a sign on the permit. Right now, everything there got kind of done. Nights and weekends. And it doesn't mean the same thing we have on the books, just not. So it will look, then I can tell you, it will look significantly different.
The site is a violation. Is that how it all came about, or did they get coded?
Came about from a court action. They have a business license, and the address on their business license is that property behind the auto store. But the business license is so old, I can't tell when I look back 20 years ago. Was it a mistake by the staff? Did that property once have that address? It just looks like a general mess. And he wasn't zoned. It's questionable. His business license had some errors in it. He had developed the property without getting a site development permit, expanded the use. So yeah, we said you have to either shut down or rezone. And he gave me the reason.
Anybody else have any comments, concerns, questions? Nope. E, the Providence Group of Georgia LLC. I believe that is in District 2.
I attended a meeting at Bridal Ridge. They had some basic concerns about fencing between the properties and the buffer. It wasn't as contentious as I thought it might have been. And I think we're working on, I mean, it doesn't sound like they're not super upset about it. I haven't, nobody's contacted me personally.
Has anybody heard anything from anybody?
Why is the staff not supportive of this?
Because it's
comprehensive
CBD. I was at first very concerned because I don't want us to lose our CBD zonings because we have those now and I don't want to see them go away. But then I started to think this has been zoned CBD for a very, very, very long time. And taxes have been paid on CBD zoning for a very, very, very long time. And the property owner, I'm sure, has tried to find someone who would develop it with the zoning that it is now and couldn't. And if he can find someone who now will develop it on another zoning, that's a long time to pay taxes on something and nobody's coming forward to use the property as its zone now. It's a long time.
Is that our concern?
No, it's not our concern, but I had to think about that. So I had to talk about it.
Okay.
You know, I can't help it.
I understand.
And I'm only talking about it because I was concerned about getting, you know, changing from CBD. It was another perspective for me. He's leaving the CBD in the front, right? Isn't that the way?
Yes, there will
shows?
Be CBD in the front.
Oh, okay.
And gated going into the residential. And if you're familiar with Abington, it's the same sort of setup, totally different product type, but the perimeter lots are standard front entry garage style. The interior lots are the alley fed, basically garages behind.
And this is the school across the street, right?
That's Home Depot, isn't it?
Yeah, there's
the
no
Home
school.
Depot?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay.
I mean, on the plan view, it looks like it would have commercial potential, but I think there's a lot of other issues if you were trying to develop it, because, you know, one, you would think eventually somebody would be wanting to get access over to Bagley Drive, and there's a stream that runs parallel mm-hmm. up through there that would probably end up having to get mitigated out. I don't know if that mitigation, that would probably be an impact that would end up going through Bridal Ridge, through whatever their residential storm sewer is. Or I guess whatever they accommodate the creek with.
Now, I do know that the residents in Rascarity are not excited about this.
Would they rather it be off that?
Well, I do know that they had previously negotiated for the CBD that they would have a very significant buffer, but I don't know exactly what the agreement was.
Was that their only concern?
So Rascarity is right here. So it's these people that are on this side of the property,
this is their lake.
Okay, this is Rose.
Uh-huh, and then...
Oh, there it is. Yeah.
And then this is Bridle Ridge here.
Okay.
Where is their road? All I see is the lake and the lots going into the lake.
On Rescuity?
You see
it goes around the lake. Their road goes around the lake.
You see where it says Rescuity Road? That's actually their road.
Oh, so it's right on the loop. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, you drive all around the lake.
Okay. If maybe they have boat slips or something. Mm-hmm.
It looks big. It's not as big as what it looks like on this piece of paper, but it's nice back in there. It was shocking when I first went back in there because I thought, I can't believe this is out here in this area. It's kind of neat. So what were they upset about? Anything?
Probably
they just, I mean, they have very large lots, mm-hmm. and, you know, any kind of construction is going to, they're concerned it's going to pollute the lake. And I know that they had negotiated a significant buffer between any kind of commercial property and them.
Just right downhill into the property
there, mm-hmm. which you can see is a lot bigger than
property
what
like is downhill.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Is it closer to the lots down there?
We are having a another public participation meeting because it was not advertised properly, and so we had two different dates. On the website was one date, and on the sign was a different date, and so we're doing that tomorrow.
Tomorrow?
Tomorrow, Wednesday.
Yeah.
So do you know why they're asking for variance to reduce the open space? Did anybody explain that to you? I didn't know if there was a problem with the topography, or there was some problems.
I mean, from what I see, the proposal product here shows that the, you know, there is a stream that goes through it.
Uh-huh.
And then it shows that there's a 25-foot buffer / open space. I don't know.
Their written justification is they want larger lots. Which you always hear.
The what?
Larger lots, expensive homes.
Okay.
This is.
But there's no other. I mean, there wasn't anything that stood out. Yeah.
I think it boils down to the other statement. The variance is being requested as the minimum necessary to accomplish the proposal.
They have some state waters. They reference that. Their justification is on page 4 of the application.
Do you have any particular problems that come to your mind? Is that a fair question? I mean, with the zoning like it is, or are you thinking that, you know, possibly larger lots, or...
I'd like to hear from some people. I haven't really
okay,
heard.
Yeah, tomorrow.
You know?
Yeah, okay.
Did anybody go to the other one?
Well, I didn't because it was on my calendar for the wrong day, so...
Be interested to see if somebody comes to this one. Anybody else have any comments or any concerns or anything?
So you're kind of open to what happens tomorrow. That's what it sounds like to me.
I mean, I'm always open.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll see.
This is going to be like a kind of a traditional neighborhood development type of setup too, isn't it?
Well, it's got the alleyway behind
it. Yeah,
I've
got the planks of that.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's gated.
It's a very high-end product.
Yeah, very high-end product with that. Okay. Is that it? May I have a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
That was Ms. Iglesias. And who did the second?
Second.
Commissioner Neal. Let's vote. Raise your hand. In favor. Any opposed? No. Motion carries 5-0 to adjourn at 8:30. I rounded it to 8:30.
This is going to be a low end.
This is going to be awful. You're right. Nobody ever says. Nobody's looking for that.
That was a good meeting.
Thank you. It was a great meeting.
Thank you. That was a great job. We weren't all too long-winded, were we?
Oh, you are here.
This is all I know.
Oh, I think that's wonderful.
I guess everybody is.
I'm trying to be scarce.
June and July.
Because it's hot here. It's cold up there.
Trying to stay.
No, this is it's in work time.
Thank you, Vanessa. Thank you, Tom.
Give it
up. Wanted to get your face at least for a moment, Pam.
Spur of the moment. You don't want that face. Now I can't get through the door.
Good night.
Why don't you put that on that website?